Welcome back to Chemistry Matters. By now, you should have had time to complete the density lab on pennies that were made both before and after 1982, graphed your density data, and made comparisons on a reference chart, just like our students. Let's return to our classroom to see if our students got results that are similar to yours.
As you finish gathering and analyzing data, it's time to start discussing your results. So who wants to go first?
Well, we graphed the mass on the y-axis and the volume on the x-axis. Then we calculated the slope of a best fit line for the pre- and post-1982 pennies. The slope gave us the average density for each set of pennies. The average density of the pennies from before 1982 seemed to match the density of copper on the reference chart, while the pennies made after 1982 had the density that matched zinc.
Right, and here's our evidence. The slope of our line showed that the pennies made before 1982 had an average density of 8.85 grams per milliliter, which is really close to the known density of copper. The reference sheet says that copper has a density of 8.96 grams per milliliter, but the pennies we measured after 1982 had an average density of 7.2 grams per milliliter. That's really close to the known density of pure zinc, which is 7.13 grams per milliliter.
Great job. Nice work. How did you do?
My graph's a little bit different. I decided to use a bar graph instead of a line graph. Does that make my results confusing?
I see what you did. You graphed the average values of the two groups in the data table.
Different is okay. Well, let me explain. A bar graph is a visual representation of data in the data table. And it's helpful when you're describing differences between discrete categories, such as the older penny versus the newer pennies. Bar graphs are fine. But in this lab, the line graph lets you easily see trends in continuous data because you can actually calculate the slope of the line and determine the density of the pennies in each group. Now, our lab directions called for you to graph data from each penny and then use the slope to determine the density. On both graphs, you did a good job remembering to write the descriptive title for the graph, and you labeled the x and y axis. So tell us what your data revealed.
Okay, well, my data was really similar. I determined that the pre-1982 pennies had a density of 8.6 grams per milliliter, really close to the density of copper. But the post-1982 pennies were lighter. They had the same size, but the density was 7.2, really close to zinc. Why is there such a big difference?
Yeah, what happened in 1982?
Another good question. And actually, a lot happened in 1982. When copper prices went sky high, it cost more than a penny to make a penny. So the United States Mint, which makes all of our coins and paper money, decided that they needed to make a coin that cost less. Zinc was more cost effective, so the composition of a penny went from 95% copper and 5% zinc in 1982 to 97.5% zinc and 2.5% copper, or essentially copper-plated zinc. The small amount of copper is only found on the outside of the coin, so it still has a bright, shiny copper color. But density is only one physical property used to identify matter, to help identify chemicals we need to look at more additional physical properties. Another easy and fun test you can use is something I like to call crushability. So let's do a quick activity where you'll explore the crushability of five different crystals. You're going to design a crushing test that identifies an unknown chemical. Your teacher will give you five chemicals to crush, one of which won't be identified. We'll call that one the unknown. Beginning with the four known chemicals, you'll conduct an experiment in which you crush the materials to learn more about their physical properties and potentially the identity of the unknown. This cross-cutting concept is known as patterns. Regularly occurring shapes and structures, repeating events, and relationships. You might observe patterns that allow you to classify things into groups, allowing you to compare them to each other. In this case, you're looking for similarities between known and unknown substances. Here are the four known chemicals: table sugar, known as sucrose, table salt, known as sodium chloride, Epsom salt, known as magnesium sulfate, and monosodium glutamate, or MSG, used in certain food recipes. Now let's head back to our classroom for a little more hands-on lab work.
Glad to see you all wearing your safety goggles. Good job. Starting with these four known chemicals, label each and place them on the lab bench. then crush them and record your observations. Now remember, in any experiment, it is very, very important to control the variables as much as possible. For example, there are a lot of different ways to crush something. So let's use the same method each time. You might want to use the back of the spoon and your thumb.
I'm going to label the little piles of the chemicals on the table so that I don't mix them up.
Oh, and make sure you crush it the same way each time.
I think you need to wipe off the spoon after you crush each one.
Yeah, it turns white after you crush it.
Good observations, everyone. Now keep crushing.
Now's a good time to continue this crushability experiment yourself. You can get the materials from your teacher. As you proceed, record your results as you continue to crush all of the chemicals. Write down descriptions of what you observe when you crush each one. Since this is qualitative data, be specific with your descriptions. Soon, we'll give you information on the unknown crystal. You'll want to try crushing this crystal and compare each chemical to the unknown. Then we'll use our observational evidence to identify the unknown. By the way, we've been using several science and engineering practices. In this crushability experiment, we're using the practice of planning and carrying out an investigation. Later, we'll use analyzing data, engaging an argument from evidence, and communicating results. And our teacher noted that we're using one of the cross-cutting concepts, looking for patterns. Patterns are everywhere in the natural world. They're especially easy to spot when you're classifying materials and dividing them into groups. When you're ready to continue, move on to the next video on the playlist, and I'll see you there.